On this anniversary of 9/11, it's quite fitting that we should be gathering here for a book that involves our military and a look back at an important part of the long-term fight in which the U.S. Armed Forces have been engaged. The Iraq War, of course, wasn't necessitated by the September 11th attacks. That war was more one of choice. But it was fought with the purpose, in part at least, of helping to keep America safe. And its lessons, particularly lessons about balancing force and diplomacy and relying on indigenous forces, those lessons remain very relevant today, especially as we in this country prepare to re-engage in Iraq and go after yet another enemy in the form of the group that calls itself the Islamic State. Dan Green and Brigadier General Bill Mullen both served in Iraq, overlapping in Anbar Province, which is in the western part of the country. That the book that they've co-authored, Fallujah Redux, focuses on a critical turning point in the Iraq War, a turn called the Anbar Awakening, when Sunni tribes in the province joined the battle against al-Qaeda-affiliated forces. Dan is a reserve. This is Dan, by the way. That's Bill. Yes. They're both pretty big, brawny guys here. Dan is a reserve officer in the U.S. Navy and served as a tribal and political engagement officer for a Naval Special Warfare Unit. I guess that's a SEAL team, essentially, right? No comment, right? In Fallujah in 2007. He also has done duty in Afghanistan, both as a military officer and as a civilian with the State Department. In fact, his first book 3 years ago, titled The Valley's Edge, was about a year with the Pashtuns in South Central Afghanistan. Dan, who also has a doctorate in political science from George Washington University, is now a research fellow at the Washington Institute for Near East Policy, focusing on counterterrorism and counterinsurgency operations. I might add as well that Dan is a regular here at Politics and Prose, and we're very grateful for that. Bill has been a Marine for, 28 years now, and currently is with the Combat Development Command at Quantico. He spent 2 years in Fallujah, first as the operations officer for a Marine Regimental Combat Team from 2005-2006, and then as an infantry battalion commander in charge of the city for most of 2007. Fallujah has particular significance in the history of the Iraq War. It became a center of insurgent activity and was the scene of one of the U.S. military's biggest setbacks in the first year of the Iraq War. U.S. forces eventually retook the city in late 2004, but insurgent groups continued to operate in and around Fallujah. Then in 2006-2007, as President Bush decided to surge U.S. troops in Iraq, local tribes also moved to reject al-Qaeda-affiliated fighters, and the United States was able to coordinate these efforts by the local tribes with the pacification campaign of U.S. and Iraqi security forces. That coordination, of course, has since come undone in the wake of the U.S. withdrawal and sectarian misrule by the Maliki government. And Fallujah is now occupied by Islamic State fighters. Now, while much has been written about what happened in Anbar, Dan and Bill offer the perspective of those who actually served there. In their book, they hold up Fallujah, an example of what can be achieved by the right combination of leadership and perseverance. Their story is not really the story of the major military battles in 2004, but of the more complex military, political, and diplomatic moves 3 years later that did, for a time anyway, bring greater peace to that war-torn area. So, ladies and gentlemen, I want to make one other note that Bill has asked me to make. He is his remarks here are personal. They do not represent those of his command or the U.S. Marine Corps or the American Armed Forces. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming both Dan Green and Brigadier General Bill Mullen.
Thank you very much. What I thought I'd begin with is sort of why Bill Mullen and I wanted to write this book. You know, a lot of the, how we remember war is so important. And there are so many books, for example, about the battles of Fallujah, and appropriately so. And when it comes to the city of Fallujah, it sort of has an iconic status. But when Fallujah was finally won in 2007, from our perspective, victory wasn't a thunderclap, it was more of a whimper. And partly for that reason, it wasn't really covered that much by the media. There weren't really many, haven't really been any books written about it. But at the end of the day, it's often more important how you finish a war than sometimes how you start it. And one of the primary reasons we wanted to collaborate on this book is to tell sort of what we felt at the time was sort of the final chapter of Fallujah, and how eventually the U.S. forces learned a lot about Iraqi culture. We learned a lot about stability operations and counterinsurgency. And there was a process of learning within the military after repeated tours that eventually we had an understanding of what was required to bring stability to Fallujah and may provide some lessons for the future, not just against ISIS, but against al-Qaeda and other groups around the world. And so we wanted to write the book to capture this moment that we both had a chance to experience. We were there in 2007 for 6 months. And we felt like if we were able to put this on paper, that maybe someday future units, which may have to perform similar tasks, and they're going to read a dry after-action report. You know, they're going to read probably a memoir. That's how a lot of people get their understanding of war from books. So that's partly why we wanted to collaborate on this. And then also, we wanted to showcase that success is possible in this kind of conflict. When I arrived in April and Bill arrived in March of 2007, there were approximately 750 security incidents in the city of Fallujah and the surrounding countryside. That included improvised explosive devices, that included sniper attacks, rocket propelled grenade attacks, you name it. And by applying a counterinsurgency approach in the city of Fallujah, which Bill led along with the Iraqis, and then in partnering with the tribes that surrounded the city, we were able to slowly squeeze the al-Qaeda and eventually push them out of the area to the point that by 6 months later, we had less than 80 security incidents taking place in the Fallujah countryside and then the city. So we felt we wanted to chronicle this. We wanted to put it on paper so that future generations may have a chance to read it. And also we wanted to write a book that showcased the sacrifice, because I think one thing Bill and I are very keen on is we want to make sure that we're not saying that it was the two of us that got it right and that's why things changed. We benefited from the sacrifices of countless others prior to our arrival. We benefited from a lot of social movements and things taking place in Iraq with the Anbar Awakening that had nothing to do with us individually, but we were able to take advantage of that. And so we wanted to capture the sacrifices of people who had come before us and to show that their sacrifices weren't for naught, that eventually we did achieve success and other things took it apart later on. What I thought I'd do is kind of turn it over to Bill to talk a little bit about what Fallujah was like before we both served there together, give you a sense of things, and then he'll share his perspective on how we started to change the city.
How's everybody doing today? Thanks. Heard you say we're going to double team you today, and you're right, we're going to double team you, so I just thought I'd add that. One of the things I wanted to add to what Dan brought up, I think one of the things that's also important to note is right going on in the military right now, there's a bit of a bifurcation. There are a lot of folks who think that using force, no matter what happens, is the only answer to solving problems. And so that's one of the reasons why we wrote this book. One of the reasons my personal motivations for writing it is because in many cases, the use of force is not the appropriate answer. And sometimes it's just putting a blanket of foam over a fire or over something that kind of settles everything down and gives people the opportunity to take a breath, look around and say, hey, we can do something different here. And the argument still goes on. There are many who believe that many within the military who believe that the only reason we should ever go to war is it's kind of like putting a glass case around us saying break glass, only a case of the type of war we'd really like to fight. We don't have that option. Whatever we're told to do, we're going to go to do to the best of our abilities. And in some cases, using the weapons in our hands is not the best approach. And so that's one of the reasons I think we wrote this. Coming into Fallujah itself, my experience started with Fallujah when I was on the joint staff before I actually joined the 2nd Marine Division. That's when the first Battle of Fallujah happened in April. The Marines went back into al-Anbar Province less than a month before that battle happened, before the Blackwater Bridge incident, where the four Blackwater contractors were hung from the bridge. And we kind of went in there pretty cocky. We also went in there with the attitude that the Marines went in there with the attitude that, hey, we're going to go in there, we're going to smile, we're going to work with people. We're not going to live up to the reputation we normally have of being a blunt instrument. Unfortunately, when that event happened, it forced a lot of people's hands. The Marine commanders themselves were like, hey, we shouldn't go into the city. We shouldn't do retribution to the city. And they were told to go in anyways. And then they were told to stop when things got fairly ugly and pull back, and that's when it was turned over to the Fallujah Brigade, an experiment that didn't work. And eventually, by the time November came around, was when the decision was made, all right, we need to go back in. We need to sort this thing out. I actually was in the city in December while the fighting was still going on, December of 2004, because that's when we were actually doing our site survey to look around and see what was going on, because we knew we'd be coming in to inherit the entire area. So when the battle was over, essentially it was our job to kind of clean things up, get the city reestablished, get things back on its feet, and keep the insurgents out. But the hardest part about that is we aren't Iraqis. We can't sort them out. We can't sort out who's who. Really, the only people who can are the police. And of course, before the November battles, all the police in the entire al-Anbar province had been disestablished by the government at the time. So that made things particularly difficult. So not only were we trying to keep people out that we couldn't identify, we're trying to reestablish the police. We're working with the Iraqi military who's in the city. Frankly, a pretty unprofessional group of folks, but they've been disestablished and then reestablished very quickly and stood up very quickly. So we had our work cut out for us. Difficult process, very long deployment, year long, lost a lot of people, trying to keep things calm, keep things quiet. Over the course of the year, we think we were able to keep things fairly well tamped down. But when we left and returned home, and I was assigned a battalion, we were still keeping a very close eye on Fallujah because I knew I'd be coming back. And I had very much had a sense that things were continuing to get worse. And of course, throughout the course of 2006, we had the drumbeat going on saying, well, we've kind of lost, let's pull out, let's leave. We even had a fairly senior Marine intelligence officer write a report saying that, well, Fallujah's lost, we'll never be able to take it back. You know, we just deal with it for as long as possible and then leave. And frankly, that was kind of hard to deal with, especially when you're training young Marines, getting them ready to go out there, and they're looking at you like, well, why are we doing this? Members of Congress, other folks, we're losing, you know, on the TV news all the time. That was a little bit difficult to deal with, but the biggest thing you had to tell them was, hey, focus. We got a job to do. We're going to go in there. We're going to do the best of our ability. Don't worry about what other people are saying. That's not your job. It's not even my job. Get back into the city, and actually things were quite a bit worse. In many ways, it was the unit previous to us was pretty much playing a game of whack-a-mole, going after folks. And the biggest sense that you had, especially after the first month or two, was realizing, hey, we have to do something different. And that's what this book is about, is doing something different, something radically different. I don't know if you want to pick up from there.
Sure. You know, one of the keen lessons that we eventually learned in Iraq after multiple rotations was that we will always win any engagement against the enemy. We can clear any village, we can clear any valley, but what is the hold strategy? Who will eventually take our place and prevent the insurgency from coming back and intimidating the local population? Now, it took us a while to figure that out, but in Fallujah, by 2007, you had a cadre of people who had done repeated tours in Iraq and Afghanistan, who had, frankly, cleared numerous villages and valleys so frequently they knew the area well. I mean, it was just pretty incredible. So the key missing dynamic was enlisting the population in its own defense, getting it off the fence where it was part of the solution, not a bystander to the solution. And so part of that was the Anbar Awakening, which I can talk about later, but that was also in the city of Fallujah, organizing local police and organizing neighborhood watches so that the community wasn't just kind of stuck between the insurgents on the one hand and U.S. forces on the other, but we're actually part of the solution. And frankly, the villagers or the people in the neighborhoods, they know where the bad guys are. They need to be part of the solution. And that makes it much, much easier for an outsider to figure out when you have a local partner you can work with. And so this led to what was called Operation Alja, which Bill can talk about, which was an attempt to apply what we call a population-centric approach to the city of Fallujah, an approach that it really hadn't been tried previously, in part because the violence was so great, but the Iraqi population wasn't yet ready for it, I think.
One of the things that is necessary in a counterinsurgency is you have the people that are living in the area there. You have to get them to get off the fence one way or another, which, of course, for them is a very dangerous thing to do. If they join the government side too early, the insurgents will torture and kill them. If they join the insurgent side, even seem like they're joining the insurgent side, the potential is that they get arrested and they get thrown into prison. So it's a very difficult problem for them to deal with. One of the things that the Marines were frustrated about in the previous deployment was that the people never seemed to help them. You'd ask people, hey, can you help us? And they just kind of look at you, and you could almost see the wheels turning their head, like, there's no way I'm going to help you. There's no way I'm going to do anything that'll make this, it's your problem, not mine. We had the weapons, they didn't, and the insurgents had weapons. It's a pretty stark contrast, because one of the other things we did before we actually deployed was spending a lot of time explaining to our Marines, hey, this is what we're going to do. This is why we're going to do it. And oh, by the way, the Iraqi people, they're just kind of caught in the middle. They live there. This is a rest of their life kind of issue. We're just deploying there for a short period of time. And for many of them, if you took the time to explain that kind of thing to them, you could almost see the light bulb come on and getting them to understand what we're doing and why we're doing it. And that eased a lot of frustration. Because many of them, you know, from the Hollywood war movies and all the other stuff they see, they had an expectation of what might be happening when they get there into a war zone. And when it wasn't happening that way, they're pretty frustrated by it. So we had to alleviate their frustration, because when they're frustrated, they do dumb things. They're young people. We had to prevent dumb things, because you could do 100 things right, but you do one thing wrong because somebody's disgruntled, somebody's frustrated, that's what everybody remembers. And you can do so much ground when that happens. So Operation Alja was an attempt to work with the police, work with the Iraqi army, and to set up a neighborhood watch to get folks in the different precincts within the city involved in providing their own security. We put up jersey barriers in many different places to kind of keep the suicide bombers from driving into their neighborhoods, which the Iraqis actually appreciated. I didn't think they would at first, but they did. Their response to questions was, well, these bombs aren't going off. But the most important piece is that neighborhood watch, because they saw everything. They knew who belonged in the neighborhood, and they knew and who didn't. We hired 100 per precinct, so that was 100 set of eyeballs watching all the time, living there in that neighborhood and reporting. And the insurgents just couldn't deal with it. And we thought there'd be a stronger reaction to this sort of thing, but there wasn't. The majority of them left and went somewhere else. We had evidence of that because there were operations going on in other areas that hadn't been happening before. And again, I'd like to echo one of the things that Dan said, is this is a lot of this was a product of being in the right place at the right time, and to some degree having the right attitude about what we needed to do about it. But there was a lot of different things came together that really helped us during that period in 2007 to really get things to calm down. As for instance, we talk about this in the epilogue, the police chief. The former police chief was terrible. He was terrified, wouldn't go outside his police station headquarters, wouldn't go out on patrol. I don't even think he ever left the building. You can't lead that way. The Iraqi Army Brigade commander, who's in charge of the Iraqi forces in the city, was actually a member of the Sadr militia. He was selling weapons to the Sadr militia. He was a Shia. The battalion commander previous to me engineered his removal. And the guy that took over for him was exceptionally good. The mayor, when I went on the pre-deployment site survey for my second time in Fallujah, the mayor was terrible. There were a lot of people focused on the fact that he was, there's a level of corruption that is kind of acceptable in that culture. He was well above and beyond that. We also think he was working with the insurgents. somehow or other, and Dan, neither Dan nor I figured it out, somehow or other he was engineered to leave and somebody else took over. We don't quite know how that happened. City Council may have elected him, City Council may have appointed him, but he, you know, between the three of them, the new police chief was brought in, Iraqi Army Brigade Commander, and the mayor, the combination of the three of them was, wow. And all three of them arrived right as Dan and I were getting into the city.
You know, the thing that a lot of people don't appreciate is for a long time, the insurgency was unified. You had an al-Qaeda branch of it. Then you had what we call the nationalist insurgents. So the nationalist insurgents frequently were former Baathists who had worked with Saddam Hussein. The security forces of Iraq, which many people know, was predominantly, at least in the officer corps, Sunni Arabs. So they had a lot of experience with weapons. They had networks of fighters they could tap into. They knew how to fight us. And so what it had developed over time is that al-Qaeda had overreached. You know, Iraqi men love to smoke. They like to drink, privately, of course. They like their girls to go to school. They like these things. And al-Qaeda had a very different vision. And the brutality of al-Qaeda, the brutality of their just, they would burn warehouses of cigarettes, for example. They started to cut into the corruption of different tribes or the smuggling routes of tribes, which is just about money, frankly. And so eventually this split developed where the nationalist insurgents said, you know what? U.S., you're no longer our number one enemy. You're maybe number two or three now, which was kind of good from our perspective. And so we actually finally had a local partner to work with, and then we use them to crush al-Qaeda, essentially. And that took a process. There was kind of a sense of collective amnesia that we had with our local partners. We knew they had been involved in operations against us. Many of them probably had blood on their hands, and vice versa. Our guys had killed many of their supporters. So it was just sort of like, we'll just set that aside. We'll focus on the threat of al-Qaeda. And the threat of al-Qaeda is multifaceted. You know, a lot of our discussion is about combat and raising local police forces. But al-Qaeda also has a political program that's very tactically proficient. There was an individual in the city of Fallujah who was sort of the political head of al-Qaeda locally. Now, he wouldn't, of course, say this. He was head of a Fallujah Tribal Sheikh's Council. From a Western eye, you know, if you're from Iowa, that sounds legitimate from my perspective. Well, gosh, he's wearing robes. He's got a beard. He must be a legitimate sheikh, you know. But once you start peeling that back and you start noticing that, you know, when he would enter a meeting, say the city council, no one would stand up. Everyone would continue their conversations. He didn't have what we call wasta, which is to say it's an Iraqi expression for like standing or sort of influence. Like, for example, Bill has wasta, as you may have picked up on. You know. I'm trying to get there myself. So, you know, that you'll notice these little things. So when you actually see a proper tribal sheikh, a paramount sheikh, and I can talk a little bit about this, when he enters the room, usually you know that because the security detail has already arrived before him. A bunch of guys with AK-47s, which we had, you know, you're not sure what to do when that occurs. But then when they talk, people listen, they stop talking, and there's just a serenity that comes with power, frankly, that you pick up on. So we had a sheikh just west of the city named Sheikh Hamis, who's head of a tribe called the Al-Bu'issa tribe. And they were largely west of the city of Fallujah along the banks of the Euphrates. And there were several thousand members of this tribe. And he had control of an area that was, I don't know, it was 70 square miles or something like this of a mixture of farmland and waterfront, you know, area on the Euphrates. And he could control that area. So a lot of our engagement was working with these tribes and working by, with, and through them. But you know what? From an American's perspective, tribes are, in some views, are seen as anti-modern. They're antithetical to building a modern state. But it took a while for us to understand how vitally important this social institution was to Iraqi culture and how family ties trump political ties. So we had a very robust tribal engagement program. I grew a not particularly attractive mustache to be respectful of local Iraqi culture.
It's pretty cheesy.
Thank you. I appreciate that. And, you know, I worked with these tribal leaders to help them recruit men from their villages to be part of a local protective force, in a way mirroring what Bill was trying to do in the city of raising local police forces. We're just doing that with tribal forces.
Yeah, I would like also add, with regards to the bifurcation of the insurgents, the nationalist insurgents, and then the more Islamic extremist insurgents, very much driven by al-Qaeda. And the reason I'm kind of bringing that up, it was very important to what was going on in the book, but I think it's also a dynamic that's going to go on today and what's currently happening with ISIS. Al-Qaeda was bad. They did a lot of things, you know, don't take Arab cigarettes away, that's bad. But they're also saying, okay, your daughter, she's my wife now. And the locals had no say in that matter. They were killing people in pretty graphic and violent ways. And I think the people of Fallujah and the nationalist insurgents started looking around going, well, you know, we know the U.S. military is leaving. And for the last couple of years, they've been very, very professional. And I've had Iraqis tell me this. Very professional, very balanced in their approach to things. These al-Qaeda folks, they're rabid dogs. They have to go. We can't live with them. And that's why I think to some degree we may see a similar type thing happen with ISIS, because right now they have some momentum, though I think it's starting to recede. They've definitely overreached, and they are worse than al-Qaeda. Al-Qaeda has disowned them, like, hey, we don't do that. You know, when you get one of the worst groups there is disowning you, that's pretty bad. So I think this group will also overreach, and at some point I think the Sunni are going to turn on them. But the first thing they need is a government that they can actually trust, a national unity government. I think we're starting to see that forming right now, now that Prime Minister Maliki has stood down. Because one of the other things that's kind of has been irritating to me is whenever they talk about the Iraqi military, they said, well, the U.S. trained Iraqi military. Well, that U.S. trained Iraqi military ended about 2011, 2012. When we left, and there's nobody there anymore to try and keep them to be a balanced force of Sunni, Kurds, and Shia. And Prime Minister Maliki took some very direct steps to push away from that, to push Sunni and push Kurds out of the military, and they essentially became another Shia militia. And so that's why many of the Sunni areas are like, they didn't trust them. They always referred to them as Iranians anyways, even though they're not. So that's an interesting dynamic. And I've been watching it very, very closely.
One of the things, too, about the reason Fallujah switched is you had an Iraqi army working with the local Iraqi police, working with local tribesmen. So, like, the Iraqi army typically has the firepower but doesn't often have the willpower. And the police have the presence, but they don't really have, you know, power. And then the tribes have the manpower and the willpower, but they don't have the firepower. And, when we secured Fallujah, you had all three kind of working together in concert. And the strengths and weaknesses of one bolster the other. And so that kind of institutional resiliency was a crucial component of this. But then the political side of this was also important. So understanding, for example, this Fallujah Tribal Sheikhs Council was a shadow government of al-Qaeda, using their placement to assassinate Iraqis who wanted to do well for the city. Understanding that, marginalizing them, and then genuinely supporting the mayor of Fallujah, for example. So the mayor of Fallujah had no budget whatsoever. He had all that money sloshing around in Iraq, and none of it really ever ended up in his office. So one of the things I try to do with my very impressive mustache was to, you know, provide temporary money to help, kind of like a bridge almost, to provide him funds that he could feed his men. I loaned him an up-armored SUV because his had been blown up in an IED. Even had my parents mail, you know, boxes of school supplies from Staples, because he didn't even have that in his office. It was such a Spartan position. But in return for that, he provided that crucial missing piece, which was Iraqi leadership and legitimacy. And he was very proactive in going against al-Qaeda. One thing that he did that was very useful, I think, for the city pacification was that we had an attack that killed a prominent leader in the city, and there was a car bomb that blew up at the funeral procession the next day. That car bomb sort of changed things dynamic in the city. So the mayor imposed a vehicle ban in the city. So overnight, no vehicles were allowed in the city. And I think sometimes we don't appreciate this. The whole city of Fallujah was bermed off and fenced off by the Marine Corps. You can only enter through a small number of entry control points. Every single house had a number assigned to it on a map. Every person who entered the city had an ID card and had had their eyes scanned and their photos taken. There was a sense of population control that we had there that was very important. But that mayor, by imposing that vehicle ban, and then he set up a series of buses to move people around the city, you could imagine applying that here in the States, people may actually have a small revolt over those kind of restrictions. But the Iraqis really surrendered to it because they knew that that was part of a new strategy, that things were going to change, and the mayor was a central part of that.
Well, the amazing part about that was he also implemented it in late May, and the heat is just unbelievable there. During the summer there, it gets up to easily 130 degrees. We saw that several times. And so when they told us, you know, the car bombing of the funeral was horrific. We don't really know how many people were killed, but it was a lot because the Iraqi practices drive in, grab people, take them to the hospital as quickly as possible. So by the time we got there, we couldn't really tell how many people had been injured. I know you went over to the hospital and there was an influx of people coming in. But it was just a horrific event. And so when the mayor said he was going to impose a vehicle ban, I was like, wow. Okay, good luck with that, because I couldn't see it working. It did work. It was a bit dicey for the first couple days because their idea of stopping people from driving, the ones that didn't quite get the word, was to shoot at them. And so there was a lot of shooting going on, even more so than normal in the city, trying to get them to stop driving around. But they did it. And the amazing thing was, over the time that this vehicle ban was in place, myself and a couple of others would go stand at the entry control points where the people are walking in. And again, many of the women are walking in wearing the head-to-toe black burkas in 120, 130 degree heat. They generally, in that society, they had to carry all the stuff while the husband walks ahead of them. Can't imagine that going over very well here either. And we're asking them, it's like, well, what do you think? I mean, you okay with all this? And they're like, well, yeah. And again, at least there aren't bombs going off. And it was just amazing. And we're not talking walking a couple blocks. Some of them had to walk miles. And we just found it absolutely amazing.
And the thing about Operation Alja, you know, Fallujah was divided up into 10 neighborhoods, right? And so the police, when we first arrived in 07, were kind of hunkered down in the center. You know, lots of reinforcement there, very secure. And then when they would go outside that center, they'd go in huge groups and very fearful. They would wear masks to protect their identity because they knew if they went home, they might get killed, their family may be murdered, their house may be blown up. So once we applied this approach that Bill put together, you would swarm one neighborhood at a time. It took like 4 months to implement completely. So you called it the swarm. So you go in the middle of the night, you completely segment off that neighborhood with concrete barriers. It's now physically cut off from the rest of the city. Then you have a police captain move out there with 20 or 30 Iraqi police to set up a new precinct. Then you add to that a neighborhood watch. So, for example, a funny story is we had the neighborhood watch. It would be one man from every household. And the mayor of Fallujah wrote a letter essentially commanding people to do this. So we had special shirts made up for them and hats. They would get food. They'd be screened. And then we wanted the shirts to have neighborhood watch in Arabic with 3-inch letters, which somehow get mistranslated. It went from 3-inch tall letters to 3-inch wide letters. So you had to squint to see. By the time an al-Qaeda guy was figuring out you were a neighborhood watch, he was close enough probably to touch. But these are just little things. Essentially what you're doing, it's an employment sponge. So you have all these military-age males who are now getting a job. There's now honor in wearing a uniform because the insurgency had so overreached that it was no longer considered sort of cool to be with the insurgency. It was now considered better to be with the police forces. And so we do one neighborhood at a time, and then eventually that just squeezed al-Qaeda out of the city, so they started serving and working in rural areas. And you know, that's where the security changed.
One of the key aspects of getting the police to go out there, though, is that inside each precinct, we had Iraqi Army, we had Marines, and we had police. And as long as we were there, we could prevent the Iraqi Army and the Iraqi police from fighting, which was a consistent problem. And we could give them the confidence that if somebody tried to blow up that precinct or attack the precinct, we were there to help defend it. And that gave them a lot of confidence. And in many cases, the only reason they would stay there is because we were there with them. So it was getting off of the big forward operating bases, getting into the city, getting out there and mixing in with these people, and a lot more foot patrolling instead of vehicle patrolling. The barriers we put around weren't all, you could walk through them, which was fine. You just couldn't drive a car through them. There was two, we set up each precinct would have two checkpoints that people would have to stop that were manned by the neighborhood watch and the police supervising them, so they could check to make sure who was coming to the neighborhood and who wasn't. This gave them very much a sense of ownership, and they really, really liked it. And again, all of these things, you think about it from an American context, and I just can't imagine doing that here in an American city. I just can't even begin to imagine that.
And the thing I also wanted to add, too, is like, why did it take so long to do this? Why are sort of the resting place of our military institutions about combat and conventional warfare? You know, how is it that institutions change over time to deal with challenges they weren't expressly designed to handle? So for across the spectrum, not just like the Marines, but also the Army, the State Department, USAID, they're all generally sort of designed to fight nation states or work with capitals and national governments. And the problem set of al-Qaeda and these insurgencies has aspects of that, but it's predominantly outside the capital. It's frequently tribal, not formal institutions. It's often in very dangerous areas, so like force protection concerns of U.S. personnel frequently trumps accomplishing a mission sometimes. And so the problem sets the exact opposite frequently of how we're organized for success. So part of this too is just trying to at least capture in book form that there is a different way of doing this, and that it's not always about killing people and breaking things. It's about enlisting them in their own defense. It's about empowering them at the local level. And these aren't things you typically hear from Marines or, you know, naval officers. It's very different from a career path. But we wanted to capture that at least at one point, because again, the bias in publishing is towards combat. I mean, there are plenty of books written by junior officers who are directly involved in combat, and I buy them as much as the next guy. I like them too. But that's not how you win wars at the end of the day. It's part of the solution, but it's not the fundamental solution. So
yeah, that is, again, go back to my comments at the beginning. There are a lot of folks in the military that think if you can do the high-end type war, you can do anything else. You can easily adjust down to the low end. One of my favorite quotes is, if the only tool you know how to use is a hammer, it's amazing how many things look like nails. And so I've always been very much against that approach. And frankly, I think that's why it took us as long as it did, because there are a lot of units over there. The only tool they knew how to use, the only tool they wanted to use, was a hammer, because everything else was too slow, too frustrating. It wasn't a real deployment to them. It wasn't real combat to them. But how do you win? You know, you don't win by depopulating an area. That's not peace. You win by getting people to decide, okay, we've had enough of this. We're going to get involved. We're going to take our neighborhoods back, and we're going to calm everything down. We're going to get the military out of the neighborhoods. One of the problems we had when I'd gotten there was that the Iraqi army had been given space in the city that they were in charge of. And it just happened maybe a month before we arrived. So how do you go and tell them, okay, now we have a plan to get you out of the city, and we're going to put the police in your place? They didn't trust the police at all. That wasn't what they wanted to hear. But the way I explained it to them is like, look, the role of the Iraqi military is to defend Iraq from external enemies. It's not to keep control of the cities. The final result in a city is police in charge of the city enforcing the rule of law in that city. That's it. We don't belong here. The Iraqi military doesn't belong here. So we have to find a way to hand things over to the police, give them enough confidence that they can actually take control. Because as Dan brought up earlier, the police were outgunned. They were terrified to go out in the city. We were worried every time they went out because they'd shoot at anything and everything. And many times at us, not purposely, but if they got hit by an IED or somebody shot an RPG at them or somebody shot at them, we call it the death blossom. It's Murphy's rule of combat. When in doubt, empty the magazine. And they fired everywhere and anywhere. And that made things pretty difficult working with them. But the biggest piece is, how do you get them to be more professional? How do you get them more focused on their job, which is to protect and serve, which is not a concept they believed in?
Yeah, I know. I'll talk a little bit about ISIS and what a possible strategy might look like going forward. I know the president just gave remarks, obviously, last evening. You know, there are a lot of things we've tried to learn from our experiences in Anbar Province and from the Fallujah pacification. To me, one of the key elements is you have to have the army, the police, and the tribes working together in concert. But that's only in the service of a broader political strategy, which is to say, how do you convince a Sunni Arab who really doesn't like ISIS but is in an alliance of convenience right now to turn against ISIS and work with a government that is not made up of people from his either religious background or from his part of the country? So you have to have a compelling political strategy, because that's the thing too, when you're fighting insurgency, it's not just about military arms. That's like 20% of the solution. You know, the 80% is having a political strategy, a political rationale that defeats the insurgency's political program. And that involves enlisting the community, not only in its own governance, but its own defense. I like to say, to use Hillary Clinton's book title, it takes a village to raise an insurgency. Right? I mean, how do you crush an insurgency? You have to enlist that population in the solution. Otherwise, you'll be relentlessly clearing and trying to hold all the time, and you know, you're just going to lose people unnecessarily for a strategy that in the end won't succeed.
Yeah. I think probably the best thing to do would be to open it up for questions, to kind of guide off what questions you may have before we make some final wrap-up type comments. Thank you. Yes, sir. Could you use the microphone, please? Or actually, Dan, maybe you can handle the microphone.
Please.
Okay. Yes, sir.
I'm curious about how prevalent your views are in the military right now, the views you're talking about today. How prevalent is this way of looking at dealing with insurgencies in the military now? And also, and I'm sorry that I'm ignorant about this, what is the status of Fallujah right now?
The status of Fallujah right now is that it's under ISIS control.
Okay.
But, you know, couple of people throwing up a flag, we got control. The majority of people are like, well, you know, they don't trust the government, previous government, I guess you could say now. So, you know, how much control they really have, I'm not sure. And I suspect in things that I'm seeing and reading that at a certain point, the Sunnis are going to say, okay, you guys, you're out of here.
Yeah.
And they'll make it happen, just like they have done before, but they have to have somebody help them. As far as the prevalence of the views in the military, it's very much a mix. because you have a lot of people arguing, hey, that counterinsurgency stuff, that's not real war. We don't do that. We're going to go do. We're going to focus on training with our weapons. We're going to focus on the big war. Mm-hmm. Haven't seen any of those break out anytime recently. And you know, you watch the news. You know, I talk to the younger Marines, and the younger Marines are. I mean, that's what they joined for. They want to go do something. And a lot of them are frustrated because Iraq is done and Afghanistan looks like it's done. I'm like, well, you know, peace isn't exactly breaking out. And it may not be the big war that you saw on TV or in the movies, but when you look at the course of history, especially for the United States, the majority of the things that we've done have been these types of operations. They haven't been the big wars. And a lot of people just don't understand that. And again, it goes back to, we have to do whatever we're told to do, not what we think we ought to do.
Thank you.
Sure. I'm sorry, did you want to answer that?
Dan, you mentioned that, correct me if I'm wrong, that former leaders of the Ba'ath Party were active in the insurgency at the time. Do we know if the current situation with ISIS is similar, like the group, you know, Naqshbandis, what they are known today, headed by former Saddam Hussein's vice president? Are they active in ISIS? That's one question. And the other one is, how do you expect the Fallujah to be taken back by the Iraqi forces? Is it going to be similar to what happened in Amirli recently by the Americans bombing the area and the Iraqis come and control the city? After all, you had difficulty, American army, in getting the city in 2007. And so how the Iraqi army will be able to win Fallujah again after almost 9 months?
I think the reason ISIS was so it was so easy for ISIS to take over Western Iraq and the Sunni Arab areas was in part because I think there is an alliance that's taking place, an alliance of convenience right now between former Ba'athists, some tribes and tribal leaders colluding with ISIS, in part for the internal politics of pressuring the Maliki government and trying to either reform or create their own separate, you know, enclave. I mean, I think that's been pretty clear. I think ISIS had a very smart ground game of political engagement. You know, before we ever saw them on our radar screen militarily, I rest assured they were already making, reaching out to different tribal leaders and different networks of former Ba'athists to help facilitate their this kind of return. So I think that's what happened here. I think eventually, like we experienced in our own tours, that alliance will start to fray as the reality of ISIS's control becomes a daily reality. So that's for sure. I don't know exactly how Iraqis will pacify these areas. I don't think it will be, frankly, as sophisticated and as sensitive to civilian casualties as I think we were when we were there.
I'd just like to add, though, I don't think it's going to be real violent either. Because one of the things that what we saw with a lot of the Sunni, especially the young guys that are unemployed, they bandwagon. So when it looks like somebody has success, they all want to be on that team. They all want to be jump around in front of the cameras. They all want to wave the flags and everything. When things start going a little south on them, they just kind of melt away. And so I think what's going to happen is once, if you can get a national unity government going in the center, and they start pulling the military back together and bringing back the Sunni and bringing back the Kurds into the military, like I said, this ISIS, they're overstaying their welcome. They're overreaching, you know, declaring a caliphate. You don't do things like that if you expect to have a long life. And so what I think is going to happen is that the tide's going to turn, and it'll probably turn pretty quickly, because if you think about it, they're fighting in Lebanon, they're fighting in Syria, they're fighting in Iraq. They've got a lot of people working against them, and I don't think they're going to last very long. And as soon as the tide starts to turn, I think the folks that are putting up flags down in downtown Fallujah are going to take the flag down and leave as quickly as possible. I don't think there'll be a lot of fighting.
Thank you.
Just my personal view.
There are so many dynamics. One of the huge dynamics is the military comes in and is unable to speak the language of the street and needs translators. And from past experience, translators really don't say the right thing. And you've alluded to some of the problems that creep up, but in reality, the dynamic involves poverty and involves good governance. It means no screwing around with corruption and security, proper security. And then there's the other problem with drugs and, of course, oil. The huge problem is the suicide killer and how you deal with that. I wonder if you could, I know a little bit about what General Pershing did in the Philippines, and I wondered if you would be bold enough to say what he did, how to deal with fanatic killers.
Yeah, the approach that he used in the Philippines,
yes.
Probably not too acceptable.
Well, then I'll say, since we're going on to the internet, Pershing essentially took the bodies of fanatics and had them dumped in a common grave, yes. Contaminated them with pig blood, yes. And dumped in the pigs. And that was the last that Pershing had to deal with that.
I wasn't going to go into that level of detail, but yes, that's essentially what I mean. That
and unfortunately, the media has made a mess too by taking things out of proportion, because most people in the military are pretty decent. But then there are some clowns who create havoc, like the urinations on the bodies. But in any event, the big problem is proper security with the fanatic killers and the revenge killers, and how you would deal with that.
At your first point, though, the interpreters versus translators. Translators, that's something I focused pretty hard on, the people I worked with and the folks we put out with the people out on the streets. Translators just kind of repeat what they hear. They're kind of like a computer. And in many ways, they get the context wrong. But if you have an interpreter, somebody who really understands what they're doing, who's been working there for a while, which I had the benefit of having, you can tell when they're talking with somebody, they're trying to get the right, they're trying to get the answer, they're trying to emphasize the right things. I studied Arabic before I went over there, so I could kind of understand some of what he was saying and some of what they were saying back. So all those things are kind of key to being able to communicate with folks and kind of get your point across. But you really, that interpreter is key. If you can get a good one, they're worth their weight in gold.
To put that in perspective, somebody special to me was a Russian woman, and who with some kids, and I greeted her by saying "Здравствуйте, мат," and didn't realize that "мат" means mother frigger.
Right, that would be a problem.
On the suicide, I know in the West when we hear a suicide bomber, it's incredibly jarring to our values and how we see the world. But when you actually start to unpack who these suicide bombers are, they come in many different flavors. Sometimes people are suicide attackers unknowingly. So, for example, there's a famous case of a Saudi youth who came into Iraq and was instructed that, yes, you'll eventually be part of a martyrdom operation, but in the meantime, you know, you need to kind of, quote, pay your dues. So he was instructed to move a truck between two places as part of that dues paying, and little did he know that that truck was actually a truck bomb. And he survived that, and he was grievously injured. But just an example, some people are, there are things that are done to them that create such a sense of shame that they become suicide bombers. They run the gamut. There are people with mental problems who become suicide bombers. So it's there are a lot of different people. The fanatical true believer is a part of it, but it's by no means all of them, you know.
And the other aspect of dealing with them is that, the thing that we emphasize with our Marines all the time is you have to have your head on a swivel. You have to be focused, because the insurgent, the suicide bomber, only needs 1 second to succeed in what they're doing, and 1 second of not paying enough attention. And that's hard when there's a lot of heat out there. And they mix in with the crowds. So how do you protect yourself? Because a very difficult problem we had was we do escalation of force. In many ways, it was a cultural problem, cultural misunderstanding between the two. And in cases like that, there were occasions where Iraqis were hurt and in some cases killed because of that. But if you get a Marine so that he's afraid to even protect himself and you let somebody in, that's an enormous problem.
And then just add one other thing, too. That's why it's so important to have a local ally to partner with, because they know who's from the neighborhood, who's from the village, and who isn't. You know, they can really help spot those people well beforehand. And if you've really got the local community organized and enlisted, they will provide endless amounts of information to you on what's going on. They'll hear, hey, there are two people we don't know who've just moved into the house down the road that's been unoccupied. Great, you know, if it was just the Marines and the Navy, we wouldn't know that. Well, it's because we have a semi-literate 18-year-old with a tin badge on his vest and he's holding an AK in his own neighborhood. Hey, that'll do it, you know.
Yes, ma'am.
I worked for USAID in Iraq in the Kurdistan region, and so I certainly approve of your approach here. But one of the things that has bothered me about the surge, and I get echoes of that and what you've been saying too, is that a lot of the success relied on financing, buying off in a sense local people to do good things, but clearly this is not very sustainable. Right. How did you deal with that issue?
Well, you're exactly correct. Not a good solution, but when you're faced with a number of very bad solutions, you have to pick the least bad one, and that was the least bad one. Is kind of the way I looked at it. You had a lot of unemployed youth. In many cases, the insurgents would pay them, hey, here's $50, go and lay in this ID or go shoot this RPG. My first deployment, we had a lot of that. There was very much an emphasis on, no, we're not going to pay them. We're not going to give them jobs. We need to try and get the economy going. But of course, if you don't have security, you don't have an economy. Mm-hmm. So how do you deal with that? And then the amount of money we were paying the neighborhood watch that were hired wasn't very much, but it was more than they were getting before, which was nothing. And the other aspect of that is what we told them was, look, if you do a good job and you get the police to notice you, your chances of becoming a police officer are much better. Mm-hmm. Your chances of joining the Iraqi military are much better because you have proved yourself. And that kind of resonated with them also. And some of them were just doing it because, hey, this is what I want to do. And as things started calming down, shops starting opening back up, I mean, one of the most amazing things my Marines noticed towards the end of our deployment is that Kentucky Fried Chicken opened up. That's peace, right? That's winning. It starts snowballing, and it has that sort of effect. But you have to get something started, and that was the hardest part.
Were you able to work on any measures to try to get local government better financed to get it to these things to continue?
That was his job.
That's right. Yes, actually, you know, the key thing was just getting security to a point where civil governance could take place. You know, when we when I arrived in April, we'd had a brand new city council that had been reconstituted. We had a brand new head of the Fallujah City Council, a new mayor. So on the civil government side, there was the beginning of a new change. So we had a new Iraqi army leader. We had a new Iraqi police chief. So all this new leadership had come in there. But the problem is it had been sort of broken up. So like parts of the Iraqi government weren't meeting locally, meeting in other places. So getting it together, getting a rhythm of meeting regularly. And then unfortunately, within 2 weeks of my arrival, the head of the Fallujah City Council had been assassinated. So I had a meeting with him and the mayor of Fallujah and a few of the Marine Civil Affairs Marines there. And as he walked home from that meeting, he was gunned down. You know, and then we had another city council member who was a gym teacher. He represented the local teachers. You know, he was gunned down in his home. You know, and there was a real point there. You can imagine when you go to that city council member after the head of the city council has been assassinated, and you look around the room and you say, who's willing to stand up, you know, to be a leader now?
A lot of volunteers for that one.
Yeah, and you know, there's that empty chair just sort of sitting there at the front of the table. And it's those moments where you ask yourself, what is the insurgency trying to have you do? Do you just quit, or do you just persist and endure and push on? And that's what we did. So for me, what we did with the mayor is, like, I finally found someone who seemed to be a local partner. You're always testing the relationship. So we just established security around his compound, which we really didn't have at the outset. I provided him some money as a bridge to cover his bills. We supported him publicly where we could. You know, I would give him advice on who to talk to. I said, you really need to talk to Colonel Mullen. He's the man in charge of the city. You know, I mean, you are, of course, but he's also too. You know? So, like, just, you know, troubleshooting and try to help him. And frankly, he didn't need much encouragement. I mean, he had standing in the city. So once things started to happen, we had a provincial reconstruction team arrive, which had a Department of State representatives, USAID, who partnered with the mayor, helped him write a budget, and start to, you know, work with the provincial government to kind of regularize some funding versus these kind of temporary measures I was using.
And one of the amazing things was USAID was working with us throughout the deployment, and we were starting projects, and we'd go out and check on the projects. And then as things really turned in the city towards August, September, and into October, we started seeing other projects happen, and you'd come up and you're like, well, who's doing that one? And it turns out the people themselves were, because they were starting to take pride in their city, start to clean the area up, starting to do things that were really kind of amazing, like, hey, this is our city. Yeah. And that was good to see.
Well, I have a suggestion for your next project, from Fallujah to Ferguson. You'll even have the same equipment, unfortunately.
Okay.
Hi.
Yes, ma'am.
Hi, I'm Stephanie. I'm a student from American University. Sure. I'm a journalism major, so that's why I'm here. First off, I want to ask, from your experience, what do you want for us readers to take away from an inspiring story like what you guys left behind in Iraq, even though ISIS has taken over the city of Fallujah? And my other question is, how did you end up winning the trust of of the city in order to change it and make it more prosperous, even though ISIS has taken over the city.
Mm-hmm. I think for a lot of Americans, they see ISIS taking over Iraq and hear about the growth of al-Qaeda affiliates in different countries, and there's just sort of a sense of what can we do about it? Is this something we just have to live with as a permanent condition of our lives? And one reason I wanted to write this book was to show that success is possible. It's not by accident, and it's a process that takes place, that there's some learning that has to take place as well, that this is not an intractable problem. You can actually do it, but it requires a little kind of local partnerships. But the problem is so much of how we remember war or misremember war is purely about combat. And again, I like that as much as the next person, as a soldier, but that's not, again, how wars are fundamentally finished in this type of warfare, I think. So I think that's the big takeaway, I would say. And then what was the other?
Well, I'd like to add on that. That's one of the reasons kind of we wrote this, is to get people to understand, when the United States military left Iraq, for the most part, in 2009, 2010, I mean, we left on our own, on good terms. Things were very, very quiet. For Iraq, it was pretty quiet. And the job we were given to do had been achieved, because you hear nowadays like, we lost that whole thing, and a lot of that I think has to do with the way people felt about it to begin with, which wasn't good. But the job was done. Now, one of the things, I could have walked up to Prime Minister Maliki and said, okay, if you do this, 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 and this, you're gonna have a big problem. And he did every single one of them, which was absolutely amazing. But that's what I think with what's going to happen here is, that's why I don't think it's permanent. Because one thing you'll notice, and Ken Pollack from Brookings has talked about a lot, they haven't taken over any Shia areas. They can't. They're not strong enough to do that. Like Mosul, about 2/3 of Mosul Shia, they haven't gone into those areas at all. The only areas they've taken over are the areas that were sympathetic to them, because they hated the central government, because they accused them all of being Shia and Iranian. So there's really, they parade on television, they've got some equipment. That doesn't mean they know how to use it. They wave the flags around, they cut people's head off, they execute Shia who happen to get caught when their officers all ran away, which is unfortunate. But the tide is turning, I think. And I suspect this is gonna go back to, if with the national unity government, I think it's gonna go back to being what it was before all this started about a year and a half ago.
Oh, yeah.
I'm sorry.
How are you guys able to win the trust of the city of Fallujah during that time?
Part of it was, again, that discussion we had with them. Over time, they'd seen how the U.S. military dealt with them in the city. Professional, balanced, and that kind of thing. That had more impact than I thought it would. In the discussions with them, that's one of the things they talked about. That didn't mean they liked us, because for 30 years underneath Saddam Hussein, they'd been told we were the boogeyman. So they didn't like us very much. But they didn't have to like us. They had to respect us. They had to work with us. And that's what they did. And, trust? I don't know that you could ever really say they trusted us. They just knew that we were leaving because we told them that and we showed them that. And they knew that the other folks couldn't be around when we left because they'd have what they have now. And they didn't want that. They clearly did not want that.
And also, Bill was there for two tours, and some soldiers have done multiple tours. I know one soldier did four tours at the same base in Afghanistan. Eventually, you become part of the local scene. I mean, everyone knows you. Oh, welcome back.
They knew me when I came back
to
the city.
Yeah, exactly. And I mean, when you were living the problem set every day, as Bill did for two tours, that city better frequently than some of the residents. It starts to become part of your own life and part of your own hometown in a weird way. So it's part of just dealing fairly with people, and honestly, it will take you far, I think. And I think that's sometimes an unusual characteristic in some of these places.
And there are other small little things, too, that help build the trust, because when you do something small, word gets around very quickly. And one of them I talk about in the book is one of the city council members came up to me and said that his neighbor's son had been arrested by the previous unit and really was not a troublemaker. Could I get him back? He'd gotten lost in the Iraqi prison system. It took me a while, but I got him back. We brought him to his house. Very emotional scene, but you can't even begin to calculate how much of an effect that kind of thing has. And it didn't take all that much effort on my part, but it had enormous impact. And so there was a combination of all those things going on and a lot of the stuff that Dan was doing to help reinforce, push the mayor out in front, the city council, get them motivated and working when they were very much under a threat. There were a couple of meetings we went to, the city council meeting, where Dan and I were the only two that showed up. We're sitting there looking at each other going, well, this is not working. So, I mean, it takes persistence, and they saw that in us.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. She's over there, sir.
Pacification is a very complicated process. Empowering people is just chapter one. The question is how you internalize changes in the population that will last after the last U.S. soldier evacuates. It seems to me that tasking Marines, a military force, for this process is almost unfair. It really requires a cadre of specialists that knows language, that knows culture, which is very different, because in the Middle East, money is important. But for instance, the concept of honor and shame is much more powerful than money. And also be schooled, these people have to be schooled in some kind, it's a variant of psychological warfare. So since the involvement of United States in the Middle East is not going to be short-term, unlikely, does anybody think about training a special force that will be attached, you know, part of forces that come to these countries and do a job that is a specialist job, together, enhanced, and synergized by the sheer military of the Marines?
Well, I know the U.S. Army Special Forces is organized around different regions, and so the soldiers who focus on that part of the world get that type of language training, that type of cultural training, and that's at least good in terms of working with local security forces. On the civil side, State Department, USAID, frequently USAID has people staying in a country for multiple years, so they have, you know, they eventually get to sort of some wisdom about a place. State Department often has a challenge with manning austere locations and violent locations with the kind of people who have that set of skill sets. But they also send many of their people to Foreign Service Institute for language training. But one of the things we had in Afghanistan, something called the Afghan Hands Program, and it was an attempt to sort of get out of this relentless careerism of upward promotions, of getting people to eventually, you know, get out of a country or out of a region, and really have someone focus on Afghanistan for multiple tours with multiple, you know, language training. And the problem is it took a war in Afghanistan of a certain size to slightly bend personnel rules to have that program created. You know, and right now the institutions are reverting back to their normal resting place, which is to say, well, good for you for having been an Afghan hand, but your career is done. Thank you very much. Or you're going to be posted to, you know, someplace you'll never really get that next promotion. And I like to think places like Iraq, Yemen, Somalia, these edges of empire, you know, if we think, you know, they need these types of deep subject matter expertise, but also that kind of relationships. I mean, most of these countries are based on relationships, not informal institutions that we have here in the West. So I think like Yemen, we need to have a Yemen Hands program. We'll be there for a long time, and this needs to be mirrored in other countries, I think.
I would also go back to one of your first comments about whether it's fair or not, and we don't really think about whether it's fair or not, because in many ways, when especially when there's a complete lack of security, who else is going to do it? And that's part of the issue is you have to establish security first, but one of the things we emphasize with the Marines and the soldiers is we have to be able to hand it off to somebody. Because our presence there is an antibody, and we understand that very clearly.
No, this is what I meant. I didn't mean to take away any
honor
from the Marines. But
you hear that echoed with some of the Marines and some of the soldiers, like, hey, this isn't fair. Why do they get to do? Why does the enemy get to do things that we don't? Well, we're not them, you know. And so why do we have to go do this? Why can't we have more State Department folks in there? Why can't we have more folks from other agencies in here? Well, they're kind of allergic to getting shot at. So those are the kind of things when you don't have the security, you have to have something in there that can kind of, again, go back to that blanket of foam that calms things down. And then the inclination has to be, we need to be able to hand this off to somebody. Somebody else had to come in here and do this for the long term to get things calmed down, because we know we don't belong. Mm-hmm. Hope that answers your question, ma'am.